Ever.
Ever.
You can thank Houston Wilderness. They give those to us for free.
Forever.
Yeah. Okay, guys, we're going to get started because this is going pretty quick. You never know how quick these things are going to go before you teach the class. So, is the speed okay? Am I going too fast? Okay. All right. Let me mention one other thing, which I think is giving us some real pause in making us think through things, which is a challenge I believe, in some ways, equal to some of the other things we talked about, climate invasive species and all those things. And that is this. So one of the great pleasures that I have is I sit on the Texas Children and Nature Steering Committee. We released a strategy in 2010, and basically it went something like this. Kids aren't getting outside. This is an existential threat to the conservation movement, not just here in Texas, but throughout the U.S., because if we don't have any constituents, we have no movement. We have no movement. Not only do we not save new lands, we lose some of the lands that we already have. Case in point. Katy Prairie, we have a mortgage note of about $1.5 million every June 1st. So we don't have any donors, we have to sell that piece of property. Okay? And there are a lot of land trusts around the country that are like that they are going from year to year, and if they don't have significant support, they'll lose them. So here's the thing you need to know about Texas kids. Two things that are really giving us a lot of pause. One is that the average child gets 7 minutes outside of unstructured playtime a day. So we're not talking about soccer or things where they're directed and they're usually not playing in nature. We're talking about just going in the front yard and hanging out and being able to do what you want to do. 7.5 minutes. The average child, according to the Kaiser Foundation, gets over 6 hours of screen time a day. So what's happening is we are raising for the first time in human history a virtual generation that is not connected with nature in a fundamental emotional sense. That's a problem. That's a really bad existential problem. Here's the second part. Our movement in Houston and in Texas is not reflecting the demographic shifts happening in Texas. So, just went to a meeting in Austin. I won't say what meeting it was. 23 people there, I was the only one. This is in getting close to majority Latino state. Those numbers don't change here in Houston when you look at the environmental community. All the people in the environmental movement here are wonderful people doing great work, and their heart is definitely in the right place. We've got to find a way to hand that movement off from people who are doing it now to the generation coming next. And that generation in HISD, just to give you an idea, is about 83% under third grade, about 85% Latino and African Americans. We don't find a way to shift the environmental community, we will become completely irrelevant. And it's got to happen. So fortunately, you know, one thing I'm going to be working with Cassidy, she set up a wonderful thing about careers in the environment ecology on Saturday at HCC. I'm going to be sitting on a diversity panel and talking about how do we diversify things. Because I don't want to see all of my colleagues' work go up in smoke because we have a people problem. That's the last thing I want to see. So that's another thing that's really making us think, how do we keep this movement going and growing and diversifying so that we can meet the challenges? All right, let's get into the story of saving prairies.
Can I use one thing?
Sure.
That's positive. The Master Naturalist course this semester, mm-hmm. spring semester, is being taught at University of Houston downtown.
Oh, yeah. Great.
And three of the professors are teaching the course. So the whole idea is addressing exactly what we're talking about.
That's awesome. That's Gulf Coast, right? I guess I'll see you guys in a few weeks.
I learned that through the meeting.
Okay. Well, I will be happy to go to UHC. So we can't tell all the stories of the prairie. The truth of the matter is that the prairie right now is undergoing a renaissance in terms of conservation of the prairie and getting people to work together. We're going to tell you a couple of the stories that are kind of that illustrate what's happening. I'm trying to get my watch this so I can see where we are. All right. Just real quickly, in terms of the parameters of this ecosystem, how many of you guys feel like you're real confident with the prairie? You know much about the prairie. Okay, well, let's go over some of this stuff. Just some of the basics. One is, it was very ancient. So one thing that we know is that there's probably been a grassland in Harris County of some sort for over 50,000 years. How do we know that? We know that through the pollen record, through the fossil record. Now, what we think about as the prairie is probably, in its current assemblage, is probably, it depends on who you ask, probably about 7,000 years old. That means the assemblage that the explorers saw when they got here in 1820, that was kind of put together about that far back. Very ancient. But some of these species have been here for much longer, tens of thousands of years. And my thing is the side of the south. It was very big. Okay? So everything in green, except for along the water courses and things like that, was grassland. So that's big enough, that ecosystem is big enough so that it's bigger than our eight smallest states. You put New Jersey in there and have leftover. Mm-hmm. Delaware, and have lots of leftover. Hawaii, New Jersey. The massive ecosystem is about 9 million acres. But here's the key that you need to know about. Any temperate grassland around the world, how many national parks do we have that are grasslands?
We have a preserve.
But do we have a whole bunch of tall grass prairie national parks?
No.
Why not? Because you can't farm mountains. Okay? The reason we say those national parks is you can't farm them. You can't farm mountains. Grasslands are money. Straight up money. And that's the odd thing. I mean, these national parks, don't get me wrong, I love national parks. I collect patches and everything. I love them. They're beautiful and all that stuff. But if they were more easily commoditized, we would not have saved them. Okay? So what's weird about it is we think about, well, these are the really valuable places in nature, and these places are lesser, like the prairie. But economically, it was just the other way around, right? So in Houston, this was the prairie town. In fact, one of the names that I've seen in the literature is the prairie dynamo. So everything in green, except along the water courses, which were wooded, and there were oak motts, like islands in the middle of the prairies, and there were places where the pines intruded. There's a place called Piney Point, not too far along here, a pine belt that kind of came to an apex out through the prairie. But most of this area was a prairie. And it was like that for a number of reasons. What we think about the Katy Prairie is just a subset of the coastal prairie of this area. And it's because it had a certain kind of soil. It had an hard clay pan under some very beautiful soil that was great for agriculture. Now, if you get down here, and if you have a house down here, and it's breaking apart because of foundational issues, a lot more clay down here that's kind of more mobile. And it was dominated by grasses, right? So one of the things about this prairie is that it had tall grasses. Here's my magic bullet. This is a picture of a grass. This is a real life-size picture of a grass. And Bob knows the routine. He's going to come up here. But I need two other people.
Yes. We need.
Come right up here, Yoko. And Brant is going to help too. We're going to start off at the top. This is a grass that is called switchgrass. It's a wet species, so it likes to be wet. Kelsey? Yeah, you can go to Milk. Here we go. I'm going to hand it to you, and stop when I say to stop. Here you go. Right there. This is what you'll see in midsummer. The grasses of the coastal prairie were so big that sometimes they had to get up on their horseback to look out over them. But here's where the magic begins. Go. Now, not every rooting system in this area gets this deep.
Yeah.
But there are some, and certainly on the Katy Prairie, some of our rooting systems do get this deep. So the reason I'm telling you this is where the magic begins is because most of the biomass of a prairie is underground. This helps it to do several things. One, it's a huge energy reserve. Grass and plants are some of the toughest plants on Earth. They have to be underwater for sometimes a month at a time in the wintertime. Sometimes they get burned. Sometimes bison stomp them into the ground. They have to survive droughts. They have to survive all sorts of assaults. And it's that which allows them to survive. Now, there's a couple other things that are super critical for us today. One is it soaks up a tremendous amount of water. So one thing that we think about when we think about flood control, we're always thinking about those pipes and the gray infrastructure. We're doing a project with Harris County Flood Control. It's looking at three different conditions. How much water does a prairie hold before water runs off? How much does a pasture with improved grasses from other places hold? And how much does the lawn hold? The lawn holds about 0.75 inches before it becomes somebody else's problem. A pasture, about 4 inches. 9.5 inches before it becomes somebody else's problem. So one of the free services that Katy Prairie provides for all of us, and I live by the Astrodome, is that it holds literally millions upon millions of gallons of water in place and slowly releases it so that we don't flood here in the city. Another thing that this provides going into the future is money. Look at all that carbon. One of the things you can get if you start restoring prairies is tremendous root growth. So one thing that's happening is, Jim Blackburn and others are conceptualizing of an ecosystems credit market here for the greater Houston area, where a farmer or rancher could be a provider of a service. They're going to restore prairie on their habitat, on their piece of property, and they're going to sell carbon credits. So the magic for prairies has always been in the soil. The soil was the gold around here. The roots now might turn out to be something that really helps. All right, you can kind of roll that up. Thank you, guys. And here in Harris County, and this is kind of a really neat thing for plant nerds like me, we actually have the most number of species of grasses of any place in the U.S. here in Harris County. This was the epicenter. Okay, I saw a map here recently, and it was like, bing, more grasses than any county in the U.S. And that's because we had a lot of different disturbances. There are a lot of things that stimulated the prairie here. I'm not sure why it was the highest endemic, but we get a lot of water here, very warm here. And these are the four principal grasses of the prairie, but there are dozens and dozens of species. Added to that, many hundreds of species of wildflowers. Some that bloom early in the year. And it's like a little bit like a forest in a succession of blooming. Small stuff blooms now, and it gets taller and taller and taller throughout the year. My first bluebonnet bloomed in my front yard this morning. Very early. And the crane flies are out very early. But short, and then taller, taller, until you get to fall, and then you get 10-foot flowers blooming on the prairie. It was incredibly wet. There were explorers that came through the Houston area that looked at, that were traversing and left these accounts. And one was an account of somebody that started off in downtown Houston and traveled for a couple of days and could not find a stick of wood to light firewood. That's because of these. These are called prairie pockles. And this is the bones of the city. So if you want to know something about Houston, know something about these pockles. John Jacob, who's teaching the wetlands class, is going to tell you all about these, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time. Just know that this whole area was pockmarked. Looked like the face of the moon, pockmarked with all these pockles. This is why it was called a swamp. These pockles brought in millions and millions of waterfowl, making this area one of the most coveted waterfowl hunting sites on planet Earth until recently. Also, making it one of the most productive areas for rice cultivation on planet Earth. In fact, up into the 1970s and early 1980s, for you guys who've known about the Katy Prairie for a long time, you know how big rice was. At its apex, Harris County, if it were its own country, because of these potholes and the underlying hardpan, would have been the second leading country, if it were its own country, in rice production. Harris County. And it was because of the richness of the soil. And it was very, very fiery. Like I said, every 1 to 3 years, the average piece of property, unless you were on a woodland area, would have burned. And so what we do today is we fill this full of gasoline and diesel fuel every winter. And we burned between 100 and 600, 700 acres of land on the gated prairie. We're trying to get to a system where every 3 years we burn all the patches of prairie to keep it healthy. Maybe like 2 months after this thing lit up like a Roman candle, the greenest, most lush thing you've ever seen in your life. And the fire regime is really important in maintaining it. So as we discuss the prairie, we have to keep these things in mind. If we're going to keep it alive, we have to be able to adapt to the future, but also keep some of those ancient forces. And the prairie was everywhere, like I said. A lot of times when I talk to people, they're like, ah, it wasn't here.
When did rice production begin on the prairie?
Rice production? So rice production began on local prairies around 1900 or so. They tried it a little bit in the 1800s. It was kind of a miserable failure. Until, because they were using some methods that didn't work and they're using some seed that wasn't ideally adapted. So what they did is they looked around the world and they said, where do people grow rice? What is that?
Japan,
China. They actually brought over an agronomist, a very noted Japanese agronomist, and some families from Japan to help us grow seed. And the Emperor of Japan did something verboten, which he gave us golden rice seed. It was a trade secret.
Yeah.
Within 3 years, the production, the bounty went like three, fourfold what it used to be. And that's when this place became a viable rice market. And to this day, if you go south of us on I-45, what are the street names? Kobayashi, Makawa, Japanese names. It's because those rice farmers were very smart. They bought up a bunch of land. In fact, where Baybrook Mall is, on both sides, the relatives of those early rice farmers own all of the land under both sides, on both sides of I-45. They also brought over Cajuns, who started rice farming on their part of the prairie earlier, and that's why our field office is located on Hebert Road, H-E-B-E-R-T. They also brought some folks down from the Midwest that farm. So it's kind of a combination of things. Yes, ma'am?
So when the 1935 flood happened, and the flood control district constantly refers to this, that land, the Katy Prairie, was actually already under agricultural production.
It was under a lot of agricultural production, but it wasn't quite industrialized to the degree that it would become later. They used to incorporate a lot of the potholes into the rice farming. So if you go back in Google Earth right now, you can go back to 44 for this whole region.
It did not have the absorption quality that it would have had.
No, it definitely had the absorption quality, but we live on a pancake, you know. And so part of the argument that we're having a little bit publicly now with some folks is, we flood still, and we have the prairies there, and it's not soaking up all of our flood water. But I'll tell you this, during the tax day flood, we could have taken an airboat 8 miles across our property. It's 5 feet deep on our property. All of that water is either on our property, or it's in Attucks and Barker, or it's downstream. So this whole idea that either it does it or it doesn't, like it's a light switch, is crazy. We can always make it. You know, I told the flood control director before he retired, I said, you know what, Mike, we can always make this a lot worse. You know what? We can really make it a lot worse. So take a look at this. One of the things we're trying to do is get a prairie in Rice University. Why? Because it was a prairie. All those oak trees were planted. In fact, they used to shoot prairie chickens in this neighborhood in the 1920s. Where is this? Is this Katy? That's Bel Air. This is Katy.
That's right.
That is new development in Bel Air. In 1911, right? That's where the Bushes live in the 1950s, right over here. And that's Tomball. And that says from a developer's brochure. It says from this, from Rolling Prairie to this in just 6 months. That's 1896. And that's why you see these signs of prairies everywhere. So what's the city seal?
Wow.
It's not an astronaut. It's not a hypodermic needle. It's not a port. It says you are in Texas, You can move goods to market, and the goods that you're going to move to market come from the prairie. That's what it says. And that's the promise that was made, because that was our first industry. Our first industry was converting the richness of the prairie soil into cows and crops and moving it to market and then moving goods out to the prairie and these communities. So there's cowboys abounding. So, you know this baloney that you hear about when rodeo comes to rodeo time? Oh, it's completely fabricated. We never had cowboys here. Baloney. That's a baloney story made up by people. Because until about 1955, 56, there were more head of cattle in Harris County than any county in Texas. We had the best prairie.
Like, we have a farm out in Rosenberg, and it's been in the family for over 100 years. But my husband remembers going and buying bulls with his father right up Chimney Rock.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it was all farmland.
Oh, yeah, all farmland.
Just north of Memorial. They used to go up there.
And where Central Market is right here, that was the origination point for the Chisholm Trail in this area.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they actually had a slaughterhouse there that the cows that couldn't make it on the trail would get slaughtered right where Central Market is right now, and the rest would get pushed up the trail.
All right.
Okay. So here's what I always tell people about the prairie. The things that you think about as being Texan identity, independence, toughness, perseverance, the food, the clothing, the music, that's all an artifact of the ecosystem you're on, a prairie, because the vast majority of Texas was a grassland when we got here. So, knowing that, we have some ammunition to save prairies. Let me just run through a couple of stories. One thing that we do know about the prairies, though, even though they were seemed inexhaustible, is that most of them have done this. And that is a before and after of that place.
Psalms.
That was called the Psalms Road Prairie. And that was a 90-acre slot that they wanted about $10 million in a month for. We didn't raise that money. So it went to that. We did a big rescue. Some of you guys were there. But it turned into that. So that was a coral reef intact. That was over 300 species. That was every bit as good as the Deer Park Prairie that you guys hear about. So what you see is almost the disintegration, the unraveling of an ecosystem. So the orange here, I did this for a Museum of Fine Arts exhibit that I did in 2011. John Jacob worked this up. And basically, the orange pieces are places where we think there could be restoration. They're not places where the prairie is in great shape by any means. It's just places where the land hasn't been leveled and there's the prospect of restoration. And you can see it as just speckles on a map. But added together, it's still tens of thousands of acres. But in the condition that the Southern Prairie was in, or Deer Park, less than a percent left. But in places near, there are some good places. This is close to Reliance Stadium. Now all we gotta do is get Center Point to stop mowing it. We think there are over 200 species there. And it's been maintained by mowing for a long, long time. So hope is not lost. So here's a good story.
At Bayou Land Conservancy, one of our main goals is to protect high quality wildlife habitat. Along with that, we really focus on protecting biodiversity. At this particular prairie, we have over 300 species of native plants. Plants are the basis of building an ecosystem. So the more plants you have, the more insects and other invertebrates you have that can feed on those plants.
There's a gentleman who works with a group called the Prairie Hunters, and what they do is they drive around to different prairie sites all over southeast Texas looking for rare gems like this. And when they first came out here, they were just kind of stunned by the amount of biodiversity and intact system that was here and the beauty of it. I want to show you something. This is called rough cone flower, and it is a real boon for things like butterflies and bees. Its leaves are super rough, like sandpaper. And what's really neat about this plant is that not only is it a great pollinator plant, but it also can be grown easily from seeds. And so we've actually collected some seeds here at Deer Park and put them in pocket prairies in the Texas Medical Center, in Herman Park, and even some places on the Katy Prairie, and it does very well. So you know, one of our hopes is that we are able to save Deer Park Prairie so we can use it as a seed bank to help repopulate the world with some of these unique species.
Native prairies like this one are very special because they contain many species that are either declining or become rare on the landscape. This slight rise that you see right here is what we call a mima mound. And mima mounds and small depressions are what form what we call microtopography. Here in these prairies, even a difference in elevation of a few inches can result in a completely different plant community. So here you can see we've got two ambush bugs. Ambush bugs are a type of assassin bugs. Just like the name implies, they're predators of other insects. So the flower that they're on is of a plant called Rattlesnake Master. Rattlesnake Master is what we call an indicator species of high-quality prairie.
This is a wax myrtle bush, and it'll get to be a pretty sizable bush here on the prairie. One of the reasons I like this so much is because these berries, once they're fully formed, they're very waxy, and the pioneers would actually use these to help make candles at a time where there weren't a lot of general stores or other stores to go to. And one of the great things about
I'm going to cut myself off.
Stop!
Here's the deal with that prairie. And it brings up an important point in terms of working together to save the remaining prairies around here. What do you save? So, why do we save this? There's Deer Park Prairie. This is why we saved it. Not too long ago, it looked like that. But that was all that was left. And you can see all the looks like pock marks. Those were all those pockles and old ancient river channels. And the light speckles are all those mima mounds he was talking about. Rises. So, places like Deer Park, super high biodiversity, over 300 species of plants, rare birds that were visiting this place as well. So, when we set out to save that thing, there were several things that were at play. We had to make a decision. Do we want to make a play for this thing? Because there were several confounding things. One is, and this brings up an argument that happens in the prairie community all the time. How much do you want to pay? When we buy a piece of property on the Katy Prairie, we typically pay between $5,000 and $8,000 per acre. They wanted $80,000 an acre for this, $4 million for 50 acres.
Who's they?
They was a developer who had already platted this for homes, and he was building some homes right behind us. We could see it marching towards us. So we had... Well, we started up an effort and it kind of failed, but he had some setbacks with the city. But when it came down to it, we really had just a couple of months to raise that $4 million. And we did have to, from a conservation planning standpoint, we had to think about this. We pay $80,000 an acre, whereas if we go closer to another preserve out in the hinterlands, in some places you could get a piece of acre for $2,000. An acre for $2,000. So some of the argument that was happening behind the scenes in the conservation community is this a waste of money? Are you doing two things? One, spending money where you could get a much bigger bang for your buck somewhere else, or are you doing something even worse? Are you setting up the price of a prairie to $80,000 for all pieces of prairie? And we got lots of calls about that. You're gonna destroy the market for saving prairies if you buy this thing at this price. Now, fortunately, that has not happened. The reason this was $80,000 an acre is it was in the middle of a neighborhood, it was platted, and he had an offer letter for how much he could sell those houses for already. So it turned out not to be true. It didn't reset the market for prairies. Frankly, because most people don't know what a prairie is. And most developers don't either. They don't know how to price it. Let's keep it that way. We all edit that out of the thing. So it brings up a question. What prairies do we save now? Do we save the hyper-diverse prairies that are oftentimes right on the periphery of the city because of the artifact of speculation, land speculation? They're small, hyper-diverse, but super expensive, Cadillac. Or do we save it further afield, not as good quality, and seek to restore it? I don't think there's a right answer to that question. I always say, get the prairie when you can, where you can, however you can, right? Where we do business on the Katy Prairie, we've saved about 20,000 acres, and the way that we do it is different. Sometimes we do purchase straight up from a buyer, from a seller. But sometimes we do something called a conservation easement agreement. And basically, what that is. We either purchase or get a donation of development rights. They basically give us or sell us their opportunity to develop their land the way that they want to. We use that as a way of protecting wildlife. So there's a legally binding agreement from landowner to landowner to landowner. So if they give it to their kids, and their kids give it to their kids, and their kid, that's portable all the way through. They can't decide to put a Walmart on that piece of property three generations down the road. What they get is they get a huge tax break, right? Because before, your land is worth this. Afterward, your land is worth this. It's a huge property tax break, right? And a lot of these folks who are trying to save that land want to stay in farming, want to stay in ranching, want to have a recreational piece of property. So they don't want to see it developed any more than we do, but the economic pressure to develop is very high. Yes, ma'am?
So there wasn't a way for that developer to... There was no easement sort of or donation situation where he could have...
Not this guy. No. This guy was about the money.
Buy it or I'll develop it.
Buy it or I'll develop it. I mean, he gave us a hard deadline. The guy extended a little bit, but it was a pretty hard deadline. So we literally raised the last bit of money with 5 hours to go. Mm. And I got a call from Jennifer Lawrence, who used to be at Vitamin Conservancy. We had slept for like 2 months. I mean, it was just all out, right? Terry Hershey, who just passed away here, gave a foundational gift. It was a beautiful thing. I was sitting here at the table when she decided how much to do, and it was just amazing because she was one of my icons. But we ended up getting donations, because we use social media a lot, from 22 states and 5 foreign countries.
Wow.
And it's an example, I think, of the kind of cooperation that's going to be needed moving forward. We can no longer do this separately. It's going to have to be in joint efforts, like what happened at Deer Park. And so one of the things that's coming along, and we'll talk about this before we're done, is that regional conservation plan, which is so critical, I think, moving forward. Let me tell you about this project, and let me tell you about that restoration plan. This project, I picked this project because it's emblematic of several things. One is the collaborative nature of conservation in terms of prairies, and also what needs to be thought through before you do this. So one of the things we always ask ourselves is, what is the target? What are we trying to do? So it used to be that people would say, we want to return this land to pre-Columbian nature. If we could turn the clock back to 1491, we're all going to be good, right? There's only one massive problem with that. What is that problem?
We don't have time travel.
We don't have time travel, and we don't know what it was like in 1491, because people really didn't start taking real detailed botanical and wildlife records until way late in the 1800s. And I will tell you this, by that time, we had had such a big impact on prairies locally and most ecosystems that the first prairie restoration started in the 1890s. We have had a long history of transformation. Basically, we overgrazed Harris County so badly with cattle that we had to look around the world and say, what grasses are out there that can take a massive pounding? I don't know, there's something called Bermuda grass. There's something called Sudan grass. There's something called, all these things that we have problems with now were brought here because of the degradation that happened in the 1800s. And we're still seeing the scars on the land. But we have to think about, what does that target look like today? We can't turn it back to 1491, we don't know. When we got here, there was this really ferocious animal, and it had this horrible rack of horns that could impale you, and it fought you like a bear, and it moved in herds, and it was fleet of foot, and it could kill you if you were on the ground. It would try to kill you. Longhorns. Longhorns became feral in South Texas. Texas, and on the border of Louisiana, crept this way, evolved over time, became these ferocious creatures that when the settlers got here, there were so many of them that they thought that they were endemic animals. They called them wild Texas cattle, and they used to go on hunts for them because they were a lot more sporting than deer, because they were a lot more dangerous and they were quick and all that. So by the time we got here in the 1820s, I mean people of European ancestry mostly, there are several things that already had occurred to transform the prairie so that we didn't really know what it looked like before that. One was that along trade routes coming up from Mexico came diseases, European diseases that ran up these trade routes and decimated the Native American population here, which managed the prairie for thousands of years, drove that population way down. Second thing was the introduction of not just cattle, but mustangs. There were massive herds of mustangs in this area. And so what I'm saying to you is, in terms of conservation and conservation targets, oftentimes the best that we can do is look at remnant sites, try to mimic to a certain degree that, knowing that when we go to those sites, we see a lot of biodiversity there, and we know that that's working for wildlife, and that's about as best as we can do. So anybody who tells you they're going to return it back to before Columbus, they might have a time machine. So one of the things that we wanted to do is we wanted to take our Indian grass preserve, which had been a prairie, and then it became a rice farm, and then it became an agricultural research station. Does this look like that part of Deer Park in its ancestral form? Not exactly. It was flat. There were birds there. I mean, there were things there. It's not like there wasn't anything there. There were pocket gophers, there were meadowlarks, there were things here. Pretty undifferentiated from a plant standpoint and from a wildlife standpoint. So what we did is we used old photography from 1930s to see where the potholes were. We did some exploratory digging. And our goal was to get some of that topography back, some of the holes. So what we did is we called, and this is what it would eventually look like if you go out there. So we called our buddy, Andy Sipitz, who works at Texas Parks and Wildlife. He had done this thing at Sheldon Lake State Park. He had taken what was then agricultural land and returned it back to more natural topography, hydrology. And he advised us on it. We went out and we did exploratory digging. We found where the old prairie wetland soils were because they were differentiated from the rest. We got to work and we started excavating. And so this excavation took a couple of months. But once it was done, we had the potholes, some of those potholes back. Now, were they of the original configuration? Not exactly, but they were approximate. We had to put some control structures in to get the water to move more along the lines of where it moved before. But that was step one. That was just the surface stuff. Then we needed to do some of the hard work, the voodoo, which is getting prairie plants back on the land. So we went down with Native American Seed down to the U.S. Coastal Center, which you saw with Dr. Seaman earlier. And we said, I need that block harvested and that block harvested because those are super high diversity sites, and we wanted that stuff. So they went down there and they made a special harvest for us. It was just fascinating. I got to ride on a combine. It was a lot of fun. Then we had Wildlife Habitat Federation, Jim Willis and his crew come out and use this Truax seed drill to drill that seed that Native American Seed had into the ground. And then we burned the prairie to restart some of that process. And we planted it 2 or 3 years with volunteers. And then we got 50 bales of hay from the Nash Prairie, one of the platinum prairies left in the area. And we took it here and we rolled it out. And some of you guys actually have gone out there and rolled out some of this hay with us. And this is seed hay. This isn't like regular hay. They cut it for when the seed is very abundant in there and rolled it out. So what you see, guys, what you see is that one project like this has taken probably 7 different groups to do. Super easy to destroy the prairies. Very hard to bring them back. And so what we're seeing more and more because of the work of the Coastal Prairie Partnership and KPC and other groups is the willingness to work together and for people to understand what their roles are, their niches are, and to work like a jigsaw. Some people are really good at restoration. Some people are really good at planning. Some people are good at this. And we're finding a model that really, really works for this area. And now, it looks a little bit like this. I can't wait for this year because we just seed drilled in some more seed. And we're going to have our 25th anniversary out there. But I will tell you this. There are bald eagles hunting in that prairie again for the first time in decades. There are birds being born in those potholes. We just found something called the crawfish frog. It's going to make cats that go crazy. It's a species in peril. It's a species in peril that we had never found there. So I guess what I'm saying is that there is reason for hope because we're learning more and more and we're working more and more together. But the thing is, it's going to take that cooperation. So here's some kids netting in there, finding some cool stuff. Now, we've lost a lot of stuff. I'm going to have to get to the end here so I can pass out your stuff real quick. Now, know this. If you go on the field trip, we're going to cover a lot of this stuff. So don't worry about this too much. We're actually going to see this where the species is. And I'll tell you about the horned lizard project that we're doing at the Houston Zoo. Horned lizard is one of those prairie species that has gone extinct in the area. And so, actually, I think probably Cassie will mention this in her class. We're actually working with the Houston Zoo to find a place on the Warren Ranch to do an experimental colony of horned lizards. It'll be the closest colony for a long way. And we'll talk about what that means. So quickly, in terms of reconnecting, one thing that I just want to say real quick is that we're working to do things like this. One thing the Katy Perry Conservancy decided a long time ago is if you got in your car right now and you drove out to our preserve, it would take you an hour. If you don't know what a prairie is, are you going to drive an hour? Heck no, you're not going to drive an hour. I've been driving an hour. So what we decided to do was make a program called Prairie Builder Schools and Parks. And it's a very simple premise. We help partners throughout the city establish pocket prairies so that people will know what a prairie is and come to value it. So we've helped about 24 schools at this point in 4 or 5 school districts. We've worked real closely with MD Anderson Cancer Center. So we're about to actually do the restoration of the MD Anderson Cancer Center because they had a big tent on part of it. But we have found county records for bees in that little pocket prairie. So we've helped with Buffalo Bayou Parks establish some of the pocket prairies. We were on the Ecotech panel for Memorial Park. We have helped Herman Park reestablish prairie for the first time in 70 years. So part of our rationale is people need to see this thing in order for it to be real. And so our next project, it looks like, is going to be the Green Building Resources Center reestablishing a pocket prairie over there where they once had one. And when the dome comes down, it's not going to come down. And these places do, I don't have time to talk about all this, but I will definitely talk about it on the field trip. These places do a lot of things, right? It's just not carbon capture, water capture. It's a sense of place. And that's really key. So one of the things that we're finding is that people, when they don't respond to the butterflies and the bees, and they don't respond to carbon capture, and they don't respond to some of these other things, let me put it this way. I don't need to mention what happened in November. You know that there was an election, and a lot of people are feeling very uneasy and very unstable for a variety of reasons. One of the best things from a non-political, non-partisan thing that the environmental community can do is provide spaces that root people in place to make them feel more comfortable where they live because they feel jarred by globalism, regardless of your politics. And so one of the things that this does is it gives people an honest-to-goodness glimpse of what Houston looked like at one point, and it gives people an idea of where they live in the world.
Connection.
A connection, exactly. So a lot of times when we create signage for these places, which is always something that we do. This is my front yard, by the way. And this is by the Astrodome. I have a very weak civic association, which is kind of nice. We always connect it back to that heritage, right? We always connect it back to that heritage because we know that we have a population disconnected from nature, hungry to feel rooted in their community and part of something bigger than they are. And they want to make sense of the world because it doesn't make a lot of sense, okay? So, we were talking with Amy Anderson about putting this thing in, and they approached us. I said, well, you have to have signage, and it has to connect with the history of this place. Has to. And that's the thing that motivated them. It wasn't that there was going to be bees or anything. It was the sustainability and the sense of place. So I'm going to go past this and get to this right here. So here's just real quickly. And real quickly, in terms of connection, we do use a lot of Western heritage cowboy stuff to connect kids to the prairie, especially around rodeo time. It's just it's kind of a natural thing, and it does help them figure out some things about their city that they're not taught in schools. So moving forward with prairies, and we're going to talk about a lot of issues on that field trip in terms of making it work in the real world and financing it and how do we get the money to do this and what species do we suppress. And you guys are going to try your hand real quick at a little bit of a restoration. But one of the things that's encouraging that's come along here recently is a program that's being spearheaded by Houston Wilderness. And that is the Gulf Houston Regional Conservation Plan. Basically, it's this. Why not bring people together, groups and individuals, that want to go in collaboratively on giant grants? Maybe it's BP oil money, maybe it's a different funding source, and work on projects together. So one of the things that we recognize here in the Houston area is that we are missing some species that will allow us to be more successful with restorations. So last summer, we put in a grant proposal for about $8.5 million to the Gulf Restoration Fund. And what that would do is allow us to work with about six or seven partners to create a satellite facility for Native American seed on Cape Prairie Conservancy land to service this area specifically. Because we think in the future, there's going to be a lot of restoration if we have the right plant materials on bayous, in parks, on private land, because we know that grasses respond really well to it's going to have a differential response from trees to climate change. We might move to a grassier era. And it's also an opportunity for farmers and ranchers to maybe get some income if that credit market works out. Another thing that we're doing collectively, and we're thinking about collectively, is how do we create bird-friendly beef? So like shade-grown coffee for birds, grass-friendly beef. So Texas Audubon is kind of working that down. So you know what you need to know is that these groups are working together more closely than they ever have. But maybe I'll just X this out of the video. But this is not for sure, and this is going to cause a lot of heartburn. Okay? You saw the maps of growth in this area. I have come to believe, and there's other people starting to move this way, which is good. The only way that we're going to raise enough money to save something that we can be proud of in 20 years is if we do something we've never done before, ever in the history of anywhere in Texas, I don't think, is to do a regional capital campaign for saving wild places. Now, scary, because you're all throwing your lot in together, and groups that don't normally fundraise together have to get all their boards together and say, we're going to create a giant fund of like $1 billion to save land in this area, because every year that goes by, that land gets more expensive, which means you get less land, and we're in a foot race, and we know of some of the places that are super hyper vulnerable at this point, and they're going to go under in 5 years. They're just going to go under. You just can't stop it unless you go buy it right now. So we're actually very happy about this. Make me the plant. We're going to have this conversation starting this spring. Could it be that we could get all these groups on the same page, not for operational stuff, but to raise the money that would allow them to really save a lot of land very quickly? Now, money's not falling from trees, but it's also, we're not a poor city. Let's be honest. You know, Rice raised, what, $3 billion? U of H is in a $1 billion campaign. Museum raised almost $1 billion. Fine arts. It's not like we're poor around here. So, keep tuned on that. Who will know? But what it would do is it would have a side benefit that I think is very important. Most of the EDs who work on land conservation, they're so mired in raising that they don't get to do the great planning and management and other things that they could be doing. So it would take a huge burden off if we had a kind of a general fund for land conservation. Most importantly, it wouldn't be grant-tied. When you do grant funding, you have to do very specific things, and it really limits your flexibility. If we could raise our own money and use it the way that the scientists tell us that we need to use it, we could come to much better conservation.
And use it to leverage further grants.
And use it to leverage further funds, exactly. And in the process, also create materials and marketing solutions that would market this area as the really wonderful place that it is ecologically, which we're lacking right now. So a lot of side benefits. That being said, I kind of raced through that a little bit. But hope you enjoyed it tonight. What I will say is that we have some materials up here for you in terms of the handouts and things like that. And for you guys who are going to go on the field trip, we will be getting in there deep and dirty, because the place I'm taking you to is very complicated. There's hunting, there's oil and gas extraction, there's stream mitigation, there's endangered species.
Salt mining.
There's salt mining. There's prairie restoration. There's a dam that's kind of broken that we're going to fix. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on there. It's kind of a problem child.
Is that where the mammoth is at, too?
What's that?
Is that where the mammoth is at?
You didn't say that. But we might talk about that when we get over there.
It's kind of secret.
So anyway, it was secret. Thank you guys very much. Next week, we're going to be looking at forests, local forests, how they get saved, and things like that. And we're also going to be looking at birds. Audubon just, either they officially launched or maybe they did a soft launch. They just came out with a new kind of bird-friendly city website. It's really cool. And Sarah and Richard from Houston Audubon are going to give that talk. I'm sure it's going to be great. They're going to talk about regional bird conservation, which is really kind of fun. And the last day will be wetlands conservation and a lot of legal challenges that need to happen to make that work. And then endangered species, and we're going to find out how that's working for us right now. Do your research. Minute to minute. All right. All right. Thank you guys very much.